Hey, folks, it's your internet pals, Mike and Alex. It's the Mike Sasson Show again on the River's Edge at www.riversedgepgh.com or live on Facebook Live or on TuneIn Radio. So many different ways that to get this show that if you the only way that you can't get this show is you just don't want to listen. That's what it comes down to. Because during the week, people come up to me all the time. They talk about, hey, you know, hey, great show, all that kind of stuff. I say thank you very much. And then sometimes people go, oh, I really want to listen to the show. How can I find it? And I describe it like, hey, you can go on to the River's Edge site. You can go on to Facebook Live. You can like the Mike Sasson Show page on Facebook. And then afterwards, it becomes a podcast to where you can listen to it on SoundCloud, on iTunes, on Google Play. Exactly. That's exactly how you can listen to it. And so, but then people just sit there and they just kind of look at you like, meh? Which is what happened to my mom recently. I was talking to my mom. She's like, Michael, I want to listen to your program. And I'm just like, well, you do all that kind of stuff. And the way she looked at me, it was like, I was trying to teach a dog how to fly a plane. That was how it was trying to explain to my mom, how do you get this show live? But today's show, we have a weird story involving moms. We also have some health things that your mom probably told you that are actually complete BS. I read this article. There's like 40 of them. We'll give you the best ones of the things that you've always been told are healthy when in reality, no, it's not. Also, we're going to be talking about how professional sports teams can be full of crap. Because they have a said standard, and then they kind of do whatever the heck they want. And today's top five is the top five dumb guys that you meet on an everyday basis. Because there's different types of dumb guys, and I want to go over them. Because I was thinking about that last night, because, you know, sometimes you just have to deal with dumb people. And you know what? There's different types. There's not just one type of dumb guy, so I had to go through that. Couple things, some bookkeeping, as I would say. First and foremost, I want to thank the Oaks Theater for having me and Alex over for, we watched Michael Griffin last Friday. I remember a couple weeks ago on the third show, if you want to listen to it, we interviewed him. Great show, and we want to thank everybody down at the Oaks in Oakmont. If you've ever never been, check out their shows all the time there. I mean, everything from magicians to comedians to bands to everything. So check those guys out. Again, thank you very much to the Oaks. Also, want to say thank you very much to one of my best friends in comedy, Terry Jones. Congratulations. This past weekend, he just finished up his headlining. He had headlined two shows at the Pittsburgh Improv. And for any Pittsburgh comic, that's the ultimate. You want to headline your home club. You want to headline what we call the A club in town, the Improv. So the fact that he was able to do that, and he had me on. He also had a bunch of other great comedians on. He had Matt Light, and again, another great local comedian, three-time champion, Pittsburgh Magazine top comedian. He hosted the show. Dr. Nancy Burke, who you remember from the old Q92.9 morning show, she was there. She's stand-up. She did great as well. And T-Robe. So a lot of great comedians there. And T-Robe, obviously a great friend of the show. Another person who said he watched the show and was a big fan and everything like that. So thank you to those guys as well. Also, a little bit of bookkeeping. Alex's mom obviously loves Alex dearly. And so last week...
I hope so.
Yeah. But this is how much she would... I just, you know, you lead off with that she loves you dearly. And now I'm gonna explain how. If you check... we obviously share clips and we share, you know, the show a bunch of times so you can find it and so you can watch it and you can enjoy it. And last week, the top five was the top five things that you claim that you love that you claim you hate but everybody loves. And one of them was disco, which I still claim most everybody loves. Alex, again, I don't know. We're learning more and more about Alex. She doesn't have a soul. That's what we're learning about. Yes. That's why she's in all black.
We're all both in all black.
Well, I wanted to do this again. This is in remembrance of the Black Album. Metallica's Black Album is 25 years old this past week. And then the thought was I had in my mind is, you mean one of my favorite albums of my of all time that I remember this being released is older than my co-host. So
how does that make you feel?
Not good. Not good, because I literally remember, I remember the album before that, the Injustice for All. That was my first Metallica. First off, if there's a band that I have seen, I've seen them four times. Metallica. I've seen them.
Wow.
Yeah, I saw them in Hartford when I worked at the Meadows Music Theater, and then I also saw them when I was here in Pittsburgh, but at the old Civic Arena, and then I saw them at Woodstock, and then I saw them like do a couple shows somewhere else. So maybe three times. I don't know, but multiple times, because I've only been to like nine concerts in my whole life that I've paid for.
Oh.
I've worked like a bunch other when I was in college, but for me to actually pay to go see you a couple times is a big deal. And one of my favorite albums of all time is Metallica, the Black Album. So last week they had like the, you know, cause I, you know, on the Facebook, I like Metallica, and every time they say, hey, you know, congratulations, it's 20 years ago today we were here or whatever. Well, this past week, it was 25 years ago, the release of the Black Album. Now, if you're not familiar with Metallica, you're familiar with probably Enter Sandman. That's like the song that do, 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 do. Like you see it, hear it at every sporting event, you know, and so that's 25 years old. And not to give anything away, my co-host is 23. So
you could have just said younger than that. What did that have to do with my mom?
Okay, back to your mom. Well, your mom, 23 years ago.
She definitely doesn't like Metallica.
Okay, she doesn't like Metallica. But the other thing is that she apparently didn't meet her husband to disco.
Oh, yeah, right.
And she made a point of that. She sat there and said,
I was right.
You were right. She did not, because I said, well, your mother and father danced to this when they met. And she goes, no, it was 1985. So actually, your mom probably met to more like, what, Aha or Madonna.
They did meet at a singles dating dance, though.
So I wasn't completely off.
No.
So they danced to something.
Technically, they met at a singles dating dance.
Where disco possibly was played.
Right. My dad creeped on her beforehand and took pictures of her at this volleyball tournament they were at. It sounds super creepy, but it's actually really adorable.
No.
The way I'm telling it sounds really bad. I'm sure he wouldn't like to be portrayed like that.
Okay.
A little creepy. He was a little, like, when they first met, if they had met now, I don't think that they would ever have started dated. Just because, like, so they were at this volleyball tournament, like, beforehand, and they had played volleyball together, but never, like, really formally talked or anything like that. And then they met at this dating dance, and they, like, danced together and talked all night, blah, blah, fell in love, adorable. And then, like, a couple weeks later, they were hanging out, and my dad was showing my mom pictures from this vacation he had just went on. And at like the end of the slide, there was pictures of her at this volleyball tournament thing. And it was super creepy. And then he also showed her his knife and gun and pyramid collection.
See,
so if it was now, he would totally be a serial killer.
Well, here's the thing.
He could still be a serial killer.
He still could be. You never know. He's a young man still. But the thing that gets me is that's the difference. There's a difference between creepy and just, oh, that's adorable. It really comes down to, do you like the guy?
Right.
Because, like, I remember, I have a joke in my act that I sit there and I say, don't like a woman's Facebook page. Don't like a picture on a woman's Facebook page that she posted there 8 years ago. Obviously, you know, you're indicating to somebody, hey, I'm looking through all of your pictures. If you were at the beach, you know, when you were in high school, and Mike Sasson likes a photo, that's creepy.
Especially because they're at the beach, yeah. Which I feel like they're in a bathing suit.
Yeah,
so,
that's the whole point.
Super creepy.
Yeah. But the problem is, and this was actually what you said. She goes, oh, one time a guy did do that to me and I kind of liked it. Because it was an indication that
it depends on the person.
It depends on the person. So if the right person. So what it comes back down to, guys, is pretty much if she finds you attractive, or you're just in general attractive, pretty much you can do anything you want. You know, I mean, if Brad Pitt could like, you know, anybody's photo from like, you know, 30 years ago, and everyone's like, oh my God, Brad Pitt thought I looked great on my prom night. But, you know, if it's me sitting there going, hey, you look wonderful a week ago, then people will just be like, what's the weirdo? This guy's such a stupid. I'm going to call the cops. I don't like this guy. But yeah, so that's just the rule of life. If you're attractive, you get away with a lot of stuff. Then another guy, I told that joke, this was like 3 months ago, and a guy, no BS, guy came up to me afterwards, he goes, you know what also women don't like? And I'm like, what? He goes, if you like pictures of their kids on their Facebook page. I'm like, yeah, I could see how, I could see how they wouldn't like that.
Where did you meet this man?
At a show.
Yeah?
Yeah, I did the joke, and then people come up to you afterwards and say, hey, thank you very much. I like that joke, blah, blah, blah. And you appreciate all of it. But this guy just came up to me. He's like, yeah, don't like pictures of their kids. And then the line, I love he sits there and goes, why did you ever not think of that? And I'm just like, I don't know. I never considered that you would.
I've never been that creepy.
Yeah, I've never gone on a woman's face and just liked, your children are wonderful, like... Yeah, so that's not good, but just don't do that. Speaking of mothers, what I do this week or every week is I kind of go through weird stories, and I try to find the weirdest stories and the funniest stories to try to help you out. This might be it's one of those stories when you read about it or you heard about it initially. You were kind of just like taken aback. The one story this week that kind of shook me, and actually I've been, you know, kind of processing it the whole rest of the week, was, so here's the story. A mother got pregnant when she was 16 years old, gave up the kid for adoption. 18 years later, these two people happen to meet. They don't know that they're actually mother and son. They start to kind of hang out. Chemistry flies. They suddenly realize that actually, hey, we're related. Not only are we related, I'm your, you know, you're my son. I'm your, you're my mom. But that doesn't stop them. They actually keep moving. And so now they're in kind of deep trouble because they want a date. And it, you know, that's still illegal. That's still something you can't do. Now, the thing that gets me is the fact that they now have a term for it. I didn't know it happens so often that someone actually had a term to it. It's called genetic sexual attraction.
Huh.
Yeah. It's
That's a good term. Makes sense. Very straightforward.
But to me, it's one of those things of like, you ever see the movie Broken Arrow, where they steal a nuclear weapon? They go, we have a broken arrow. And they go, what is that? He goes, it's when we steal a nuclear weapon. And I'm like, this happens so often, they came up with a name for it.
Yeah.
And that's the thing. This happens so often that someone said, what should we call it when a mother and son, let's call it genetic sexual attraction. Now, if you sit there and say, Mike, you're a liar. I don't believe you.
It's real.
It's real.
I'll verify it.
And here is the audio right now, so you can listen to said people.
I'm your mom and you're my son, and I am falling in love with him. He said, are you really? I said, yes, I am. He said, you know what? I was scared to let you know, too. I am, too.
We're both consenting adults. If it comes down to it, you know, it's just like the gays. They're you know,
the gays.
As long as they're over 18, everything's fine.
Now it says the U.S. wants to jail them for 18 months.
Date your mom. And he said, well, you date your son? I said, honest truth, yes, I would. Because 19 years, you're the best thing that ever happened to me, and I really want to be with you the rest of my life.
The first approach was actually me. What happened was we were hanging out and, you know, just talking, you know, just laughing, and I looked at her and she looked at me and I kissed her. It was a real kiss. It had feelings behind it. It had a spark.
Sometimes I call him Hinojito, as that means son. Once in a while he calls me mom, you know what I mean?
Their case is about whether I have the right to love somebody. I sure as hell have the right to love Monica.
There you go. That's genetic sexual attraction.
My opinion?
Go ahead, give it.
I think that it's fine. As long as they're not having children, I don't see why it matters.
Well, that's this was what I was thinking. We're on the same wavelength, is that one of my tenets of my life that I try to live by is if it doesn't affect me, then I don't care.
Right.
If it doesn't directly, hurt me, or you don't steal from me, or you don't make my life more difficult, then do whatever you want. And also the kid thing. Most kids shouldn't be born. Most kids, if you ever walk around a mall and you see the two people getting together and then their mutant spawn, most people shouldn't be procreating. If there was an institution of a rule, I wouldn't be completely against that. There, you should get a license to have a kid. But go ahead.
What I don't understand is, so they want to put them in jail for 18 months. Like, what is that going to do? They're just going to be together afterwards anyways. Like, that's not going to do anything.
Again, well, the problem is that also there was a separate article that says people in the town have threatened to physically harm them.
Really?
Yeah, that there's people in the town that are physically sitting there. Now, understand, the Mike Sasson Show is not pro-incest.
No.
We are not. We're not advocating, you know, going up to your mom and, you know, or your dad or whatever and doing whatever you want. We are advocating the fact that, and we're on the same page, whatever you do or whatever someone else does, if it doesn't affect you, who cares? It's not that life's too short. And here's the other thought process. Let's say we do ban them. Let's say we say, hey, you can't possibly deal with that. Would you like to be the person that follows up this relationship?
Right.
Would you like to be dating some woman and you're just like, well, I'm coming off, you know, I'm kind of a rough breakup. I'm like, oh, really? And then tells the story about, well, I gave up my kid and then I fell in love with him and I still kind of am, but legally I can't, you know, you're just like, you know what? You're better off just getting out of the dating pool in general and just being with who you want.
So the other thought I have on this, which this is literally a note in my phone because I thought of this once just out of the blue. But like sperm bank donors,
mm-hmm.
you know, like they could be doing this all the time because they don't know who their kids are. You know what you mean? Like,
absolutely.
They could be having sex with their kids all the time and they don't know.
Yeah, there's a lot of different. I mean, like, well, just how about like you're just some guy. And when you were 18, you got with some girl in some random town, like you're a rock star. You're Mick Jagger, whatever. I mean, Mick Jagger is going to marry or is married to a 29-year-old woman. So there's a good chance, not a good chance. I mean, obviously not like it happens every, not like Mick Jagger's like, oh, no, yes, I was touring in Brazil and then I've had sex with like four of my daughters. But by the way, pinpoint Mick Jagger. Yeah, oh, yeah. My God. You close your eye. You think you're hearing Jumpin' Jack Flash. But you're right. It could. I mean, like you think. Okay. So back in like the 70s, he had some random, you know, girl in the, you know, in a bathroom of a Denny's, leaves town because that's where Mick Jagger back in the 70s did all his coke, in random bathrooms and Denny's in Sao Paulo, Brazil. Flew off, lived his life, married Jerry Hall, all that kind of stuff, comes back. Now, obviously, the woman is attractive because guess what? He wanted to bang her, you know, 20 years ago. So obviously the daughter is probably looking pretty good too. And then his sister goes, hey, that looks nice. There has to be, if you're that level of player, see, to me, you know, now you're getting my brain worked up. Like always when, you know, people say, "Who? There's too much of an age difference there." I think subliminally, that's what they're thinking. They're sitting there going, "There's you're raising the chance that actually could be your offspring."
True.
Because if you're dealing with someone that's only like a couple years difference, then it's like, nah, there's no chance.
Right.
But especially now with single parents and everything like that, you know what? You gotta be really. This is the future. This is the business we have to go into. The business we're going to go into is there's going to be an app. We're going to have a 24-hour place. It's for guys that have a lot of money or, you know, just still look good when they're in their 40s or 50s. And they're sitting there going, hey, I really want to dig on this younger girl, but I really want to make sure that in no way I'm related. Like, it'll be at, like, a drugstore, like one of those 24-hour places. And so they, you know, and so they open up and just be like, honey, just to make sure, you know, let's take a little blood test, you know, and in the future that'll take like, it'll be like one of those machines that take, you know, like blood pressure. It'll take like 6 seconds and then they'll sit there and they'll just go, no, she's not your daughter. I'm like, all right, let's get at it. And we're already at a drugstore. So now anything else we need, we're all set.
That sounds perfect. Phew.
Business money ideas. Maker. Money maker. That's what this show should be called. Mike Sasson, the money maker. First idea from the Mike Sasson Show is a 24-hour place to make sure that the woman you're about to procreate with is not a blood relative. That's, I believe I'm doing the Lord's work. That's what, that's, I was put here. Like, understand, okay, I was a salesman, then I got into broadcasting, then I got into stand-up comedy, then I got this show, everything like that. I met Alex, I went, you know, I met the, you know, Brian from the River's Edge, I got this opportunity, blah, 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 blah. All of that led to this business idea. Because it's going to happen more and more. Because to me, you know, with more people just having random hookups, and then, you know, people wanting to, you know, especially rock stars, I should be directly selling this to any band touring over the age of 50. Because there's a good chance. Right now, I bet you Slash on tour with Guns N' Roses has had at least three close calls. At least three. And he's only been, you know, touring with Guns N' Roses as this stadium tour for the past month and a half. So there's a good chance at least three. Now, Axel, he just goes straight to a buffet because he's on the chubby side. But in, you know, but Slash, again, just had a recent divorce. I bet you that's a real concern. If his manager, if someone can get in touch with Slash's manager, we have a business idea that actually could help him out. So make sure you do that. Back to another thing I wanted to talk about. Like I mentioned before, I don't know why this reminded me of the thing that I wanted to talk about prior, but as I mentioned before, I was on Terry Jones's show.
Yeah.
Yeah. All right. Okay. I was on Terry Jones's show. Now, one of the things that was one of the fun things about this show was that when you do a headlining show at a big club like the Improv, they make a giant poster to say, hey, coming up in, you know, in 2 weeks, it'll be John Lovitz, it'll be Pauly Shore, whatever. Well, they made one for Terry Jones. Now, the only problem is they had the wrong black guy on it. They just had a random person on it that wasn't Terry Jones. And he actually led his show off with it. He opened up the poster and said, who the hell is this? It's like
they just got a random stock image of some black guy and put it on there.
Well, that's the thing. He said, did they just Google the term black comedian and this guy came up? Now, so what he did, when this is the power of social media, and again, this is why I brought it up, because it's like this jogged the memory about the whole like 6 degrees of separation. You never know who knows who. Is he put on a Twitter for comedians and he put the picture on and said, hey, maybe someone could help me find this guy. And in like an hour, they did.
What?
His name is actually Corey Jones. Now, here's how weird it is. He's a New York comic. So then I go, New York comic. I've been up to New York a couple times. I have a lot of friends up in New York. Let me see. Turns out we have like 30 mutual friends. So last night, just on a whim, I friended him. I sat there and went, here, boom. I wake up this morning. Now I'm friends with both Corey Jones and now, of course, Terry Jones. So you sit there, and go, oh, this random guy. No, now I'm Facebook friends with the random guy. That's how close by. Which brings me back to my business proposal, which is you never know, especially if you're an older dude, if possibly the young girl that you're vibing at the bar could possibly be of relation to you. Because you're sitting there going, oh, there's no chance. It's random. Again, I thought there was no chance that I would ever find out who this guy is. Not only now do I know who he is, people I know who he is. And now I'm Facebook friends with him. So theoretically, because we post this on Facebook Live, he could be watching this right now.
Probably.
Probably, because this is one of the most widely watched shows in all of comedy. The people, if you go to any show, you go to the belly room of the Comedy Store in L.A., they sit there and all they're talking about is, hey, did you hear about Alex thinking that was pretty cool about incest? Yeah, I did think that was pretty cool about incest. That is actually a good idea. Mike is a genius business person to think about that idea for Mick Jagger. Absolutely. Or comics. That actually would be working. Again, I'm jumping around a lot. But for comics, that actually is not a bad idea, especially if you're famous. Like, because, you know, you're 21, 22 years old. You're featuring at some club, the Laugh Hole in Sioux Falls, South Dakota. You hook up with a waitress. And then you're headlining 20 years later at the local university. You see some, you know, lovely woman in the front row, and who knows? again, this is, but it has to be speed. I have to figure this out. I might have to stop this show right now and just figure. The rest of the show is just me writing and scribbling and Googling.
I'll dance.
You'll do the bobblehead thing.
I think I drank too much coffee this morning, as my hands are shaking like this. I don't think you can see it from over there, but they are a lot.
Did I get you too powerful a coffee?
No.
Because that's the other, behind the scenes. Alex has rarely asked me to bring her anything. And so she did say, she goes, bring me some coffee. So I went and got some coffee for her. And I guess
I've only had a couple of sips of it. It's because I had coffee this morning, then I had coffee on my way here, and then I had this coffee right now.
So before 10 a.m., you're already up on your third cup of coffee.
I'm going to crash real soon.
Yeah, you're going to be...
Better get the show over with before that happens.
I think most of the people listening are sitting there saying, could you get this show over with as soon as possible? Moving on to the world of sports. There's some different sports things that have happened that I think are kind of interesting. One thing is just a quick take on something that's local. About a year ago, Al Jazeera America, which, by the way, doesn't even exist anymore, ran a report basically claiming that there was that they had a link between a certain firm of PEDs and certain active NFL players, one of them being James Harrison of the Pittsburgh Steelers. And now there's no proof. There's never been a confirmed drug test, anything like that. But the NFL wants to interview all these players. Like one of them is like Julius Peppers. Another one's Clay Matthews. Obviously, James Harris. One of the names initially was Peyton Manning. All of these names mean nothing to Alex over there, except
for
James.
The Peppers guy.
The Peppers guy. you just reminded you of Peppers. But I've had some Julius Peppers. They're lovely. You get them sauteed.
That's how I pick my fantasy football team.
Is
names, smiles, good looks.
And you know what? That's as good as any other way to pick your fantasy football team. Every year, you know, I mean, I go in there. Again, we're jumping around a lot today. It's obviously the coffee and the fact that, you know, I'm just a weird dude. But, like, one of the things that frustrates me every year in fantasy football, I mean, like, I pride myself in knowing the game of football. And then someone wins because they just sit there and they just go, you know, I always liked 14. It was my favorite number. So I picked him as my quarterback, and he scores 80 points a game. It's unbelievable. I didn't even know. Or just, you know, I've always been a huge fan of his shoes. I saw his shoes commercial, and I loved it. It's just wonderful. I don't know why I made him just a weird dude with the
camera. Well, that was a dude. That was a woman.
It could be both.
Okay.
Whatever your preference, what that was.
Okay.
Even more Mick Jagger. If you feel, hello, this is Michelle Jagger. This is Mick Jagger's daughter, who he had sex with. But my whole goal in life is just to make Alex either smile or wince, like she just did. But moving on. But to go back on to James Harrison, at the end of the day, they gave up the rights because of their collective bargaining. He's gonna have to talk. I know it sucks, but he's going to have to talk. Or he might just retire, which would suck for the Steelers because already like 10 players are deciding they don't want to play. But moving on, going on to sports, other related. Jonathan Papelbon, who
not a real person.
That is absolutely a real person. He's
that
somebody
sucks.
He does suck. He just got released by the Washington Nationals. And the thing about him is he's just the way they describe him in this article. He just got released because Mark Melanson of the Pirates went there. Now they don't have to deal with his BS anymore, so they got rid of him. He was an overgrown 15-year-old boy, and he's in his 30s, and he's always been able to throw a ball 90 something miles an hour, so people let him be an overgrown 16-year-old boy. And now that he's, you know, not that good anymore, everyone's like, you know what, you're immature. 10 years ago, when he was striking everybody out, it was like, oh, he's quirky. But now that, you know, that's the thing. Everyone always talks about, like, how is it to be a coach? Because I was a coach. If you ever talk to a college coach, a pro coach, high school coach, if you're this level of annoying, like, if your annoying level is at, like, an 8, you better be, like, a 10 talent. If you slip to being, like, a 6 or a 7 and your annoying level stays at that, that's when they get rid of you. That's where they say goodbye. And that's in all aspects. You know, Tom Cruise, when he was producing $200 million blockbusters every year, no one said anything about the fact that he's weird on set and all the Scientology. As soon as his movies start to tank a little bit, now everything comes out that he's, you know, as long as you produce, nobody cares what you do. As soon as you stop producing, that's when everybody sits there and goes, he's a little bit of a weirdo. But here's the thing about Jonathan Papelbon that I thought was just really, really weird. He just always would try to mess with his teammates. And one of the things he tried to do is he tried to play. Apparently the guy might be slightly right wing or the guy's just like a jerk. He played a song that is, it's called Vote for Trump. It's based upon, it's just the country guy singing about Vote for Trump. Now imagine in a Major League Baseball locker room, probably about a third of the players aren't even from America. They're Latin America. So obviously they're probably not huge fans of Donald Trump. And, you know, a good percentage of them, other people are African American. They're not a huge fan of Donald Trump. The other group of people are, you know, went to college. So they're not a huge fan of Donald Trump. So it turns out that, like, probably out of a group of 25 grown men, two are like, I'm not too whatever about him. And then this guy's like, no, I love Trump. But what I wanted to do is I wanted to play the song. It's a country song, and I'm going to play it until even I get annoyed with it, because I just think it just shows just where we are in a country. It's just so Alex, you tell me when you stop wanting to hear it.
No.
Okay. Now imagine this in the locker room. You're trying to get ready for a
game. In recent years, this country's gone to hell. And the crack's getting bigger on the side of that Liberty Bell.
How can you even know that?
Well, Clinton, Obama, and the Democratic crew sure did a number on me and you. It wasn't my vote, you can blame yourselves for that. But we got a chance to turn things around. You can get your butt up off the ground and understand we're all gonna have to work.
Don't even dance to this.
This country was built on sweat. We're gonna make it great again, you're gonna get wet. But the first things first, we all gotta vote for Trump. Vote for Trump. Donald Trump.
Now you can, now it kicks in.
And hell with the rest, he'll get us onto the hump. And down the road, we'll all go. And a wall get built by Mexico. First things first, we all gotta vote for Trump.
Okay, first off, let's just review it from the first half of the song. Number one, I love that the only word that he could find with Trump was hump. He'll get his over that hump.
I really like the melody, which like kind of sucks. I mean, I want to dance to it and like it.
It's, I mean, if you walked into a country bar and there were people line dancing to this, you wouldn't be like, wow, I can't believe anyone could be line dancing to this. I just love the fact that he just, you know, the one hump. He's getting over that hump. Now, again, remember, this is something that someone played in a Major League Baseball locker room in front of grown men and wondering why everybody in the room hated his guts. Everyone's like, good, get rid of him. He sucks. When he threw 98 miles an hour, everyone's like, you know what? We'll listen to the stupid song, strike everybody out, and we can go home. But then when he started throwing 94 and everyone started tattooing him, and oh, by the way, last year he was throwing punches at their best player, Bryce Harper. So he's just an all-around jerk. Let's continue with this wondrous tune again.
Oh, really?
Yeah, let's because there's one line in it that's just really kind of stupid. I mean, even if you compared to everything else, yeah.
The working man tells the truth that we can understand. If you don't like it, you can all just kiss our ass.
Kiss our ass.
He pays his own way, don't take no crap. Gonna bring back country, get rid of crap. And if nothing else, we can all thank Donald for that.
Thank you.
Did you hear what he just said, that one of the things Trump's going to do? He's going to get rid of rap.
Yeah. Obviously.
I've never heard him actually make that statement, that he's going to
That's
get
like
rid of.
That's like his main point on his commercials.
Make America great again by bringing us back to like swing music in the 40s. But like, that's the one thing. Like, again, the guy's trying to find out things that like you can rhyme with. But I love the fact he's going to get rid of rap. Like, could you imagine
bill number 3415 in the House of Representatives is to get rid of hip-hop music in America.
And then everyone's just sitting there, like, can you imagine that bill got brought up? Mr. Donald Trump today decided to push the envelope as he decides to try to get rid of Grandmaster Flash. It's like, what is he doing? And then
you never know.
And if you don't like it, you can kiss my ass. Here's the other thing. You're trying to get people to your side. You're not, if this is a true, like, campaign song, you're trying to sit there and say, hey, we're all in this together. We're going to do that. I mean, if Hillary Clinton sat there and a Katy Perry sang a song, it's like, vote for Hillary. And if you don't, you can kiss my ass. And it's just like, no, you're not helping.
Like Katy Perry.
Again.
Great impression.
Master of a thousand voices.
Mm-hmm.
All of them slightly off. That's how I promote myself to the clubs. It's like I'm an impressionist, but everything's slightly off. Like there was an impressionist once that was trying to do an Arnold Schwarzenegger impression, and he was always off with it. So then he just advertised that, oh, I'm Arnold Schwarzenegger's kind of slow brother.
There you go.
There you go.
That's a good way to do it.
Yeah, that was Katy Perry's less talented sister, Jenny Perry. That's what that was. That's what that was, they kiss my ass song. But it goes back to the fact that this guy played in Major League Baseball for 10 or 15 years, and no one ever said anything. Now, moving on to other sports people being full of crap, Aroldis Chapman, who is a closer for now the Cubs. He used to be a closer for the Reds. Then he got traded to the Yankees, and then the Yankees sucked this year, so now they traded him to the Cubs, and he's the Cubs guy. Now, he has been charged with domestic violence. Okay. Now, here's the issue. Why is he still pitching? Because he can pitch 100 miles an hour. So everyone sits there and says,
he can beat women.
Yeah,
that's
whatever.
Fine.
But here's again why the thing that pissed me off. So this past Sunday, he goes up and he's getting ready to pitch. And in between innings, before he gets up and pitch, they play the song from Prodigy, Smack My Bitch Up.
Are you serious?
Very serious.
Yeah, all of this stuff sounds made up. All their names, the stories.
But
it's real.
That is real. Before, it was a Sunday night nationally televised game, and before Aroldis Chapman gets up to pitch, they play the song from Prodigy, Smack My Bitch Up. Now, here's the thing. So they make an announcement the next day. The Cubs say, we have fired that guy.
The guy who played the music?
The guy who played the music, the guy who decided to play Prodigy, Smack My Bitch Up, we have said, get rid of him. Now, here's my problem. The problem isn't the guy played the wrong song. The problem is you have a guy on your team in which that song is an issue. That's the, don't you fired the guy making $40,000 a year, not the guy who's, who actually is the issue. I mean, that to me, that's why I talk about, like, just, I mean, again, with Jonathan Papelbon, no one cared that this guy was an idiot when he threw 98 miles an hour. And again, Aroldis Chapman. Yeah, strike everybody out. You can do whatever you want in life. But we're going to get the guy who reminds people that there's a reason why maybe this guy shouldn't be on my team. Because the problem is the song. That's the, not the Cubs announced that, this actually points out the fact that this guy shouldn't be on our team. So we've actually gotten rid of Aroldis Chapman. Oh, no. That could mean that the guy who throws 100 miles an hour goes to somebody else's team. So we're going to keep this guy on. Again, I'm getting almost more and more on your side with the anti-sports if this is how they're going to.
Yay.
Not exactly there yet. Well, again, another story that sounds, made up. And I told you last week that the new general manager of the Detroit Lions is actually someone who at one time was a equipment guy for the UConn football team when I played for UConn. Well, when he got announced as the general manager of the Detroit Lions, one thing he said is that we have a zero tolerance policy to bringing in any player. And he said it with this kind of conviction. This is UConn conviction. This is how we do it in Storrs, Connecticut. He sits there and goes, we have a zero tolerance policy on bringing anybody on our team that has anything to do with domestic violence or weapons. except for the fact that today they brought in and signed a guy named Andrew Corliss, who was charged with firing a weapon at a club in Miami. So it took him about 6 months to stop that whole zero tolerance policy. Or maybe he didn't go to the same math classes that I did at UConn and realize what zero means.
Wow.
Yeah. Zero. Now, just so you know, Mr. Quinn, hi. Hi. You used to wash my jockstrap. Here's the deal with zero means. Zero means lack of any value, meaning none, no tolerance. Not like, and then the coach comes out and goes, oh, well, we've already said, we take it by a player-by-player basis. No, that's not what zero policy means. That's not what zero tolerance means. Zero means none. So maybe he didn't do his research. I don't know. So got to jump on that one, even though I'm proud of him that he became the general manager. But obviously, you know, if you're going to say zero tolerance, then zero tolerance is what you mean. All right, moving on. Again, I've been going over a lot of dumb guys. And I was thinking the other day, as one of the most... Alex, do you believe that... Here's something I've said in comedy, and it typically gets an applause break because people agree with it. That's what you need. Laughter means I agree. Clap means you're speaking the truth. We have to live our lives now with this attitude, with this, in a world where it seems like the stupid have won, and now we all have to act accordingly. Like the people that actually have any sense are now in the minority, and so we have to go to the whims of the stupid. Do you agree with that?
Sure, yeah.
Okay. You're just sitting there saying, Mike, I just want to get this show over with. But,
no.
But... that's what today's show is about. Today's show is about, or today's top five is about, the top five dumb guys that you meet on a daily basis. And of course, we got to play the song. The top five dumb guys that you meet on a daily basis. By the way, Alex, if I'm ever depressed, can you just like Facebook, like live me and just do that? That's just.
Yes.
There's no way you could be unhappy if that's what you look at. You could be on your deathbed. If Alex is your nurse and walks in doing that, you're like, life's pretty good. All right. So just so you know, last night I'm thinking, I always think of my top five the night before. And so I'm trying to do something a little different, something a little bit, you know, more thought-provoking, something a little deeper. And I go, Mike, what is your frustration in life? And then just as I've said before, dumb people. That's where the frustration is. Like, if you ever want to know how to, comedians have told me, if you ever want to find out, like, I don't know what to write, just ask yourself, find the frustration. Well, my frustration is with dumb people. So here it is. The top five dumb people that you run into on a daily basis. Number five dumb person is the guy who was born on third base, dumb guy, who's never lost, so he thinks he's just that good. You ever had to deal with somebody like that, Alex? Just somebody that just always in their lives, because they were born either rich or they were born athletic or they were born something like that, and so they walk around going, no, I'm just... it's not that I was born with any sort of advantage. It's just that all of the things that I've achieved in life are mine. So you can't tell me any different because I have succeeded in so many different things when in reality it's because, hey, buddy, you were born on third base. Don't walk around like you hit a triple. And there's three areas that I've dealt with in my life that those people kind of exist. Number one, growing up in Fox Chapel. Lots of people who have that dumb guy syndrome. Two, media. And three, athletics. In those three things, that's like where they live. That's the type of people that you deal. People who just sit there all day and just, you know, oh, how can you? No, don't tell me how to run this XYZ play. I ran it to perfection you ran it to perfection because you were big and fast and strong. That's why. It's not because you were a better person. It's not because you worked any harder. It's just that's what happened. So that's the five. By the way, as you can see, I wrote down like 20 of these. There's a lot of different dumb guys that I'm
never seen you write that much.
I've never written that much. If you've ever seen my stand-up. Number four is the guy who only hangs out with people who thinks like him, but he claims he's tolerant. That dumb guy.
Right.
The guy who just sits there and goes, I am absolutely just, I believe in just taking people's information and just not making any judgments about anything in the world. But then all of a sudden someone comes in with a different opinion and he just kind of goes off. And then someone's hurting his safe space. So that's another type of dumb guy that I hate dealing with. If you're really truly tolerant, you sit there and you listen to the person and you very, very respectfully say, well, this is why I disagree with you. Not, nope, I will not at all deal with your opinion because there's no way that my opinion could be incorrect. Again, that's the number four dumb guy you got to deal with on a daily basis. Number three, the guy who tells you that something sucks when they have no firsthand knowledge of it. This happens all the time when you go around the country and you say, hey, I'm from Pittsburgh. Like, ooh, that's kind of rough. Hey, you ever been there? Nope. And you can't say it sucks. I could tell you Cleveland, not a big fan. Why? I've been there about 30 times. I've sat there and I've said, you know what? Not a big fan. I've been to Detroit. I've been to Philadelphia. You know what? Actually never been to Los Angeles. So you'll never hear me say, Los Angeles sucks. I can't imagine living in that gruesome hellhole. Never been there.
Yeah, I don't like Philly, but I've been there.
Yeah.
Multiple times.
Yeah. So you have absolutely firsthand knowledge and personal experience of not liking Philadelphia.
Yeah.
Which is pretty much the experience most people have in Philadelphia.
Yeah, but I'm not going to say it sucks. I'm just going to say that I strongly dislike it there.
But if your opinion was that I didn't like it there, and the way you described it was, it sucks.
It does.
Okay, then that would be correct. Because that's your opinion, that's what you've had, you've developed an opinion. I hate people who have no firsthand knowledge of a place or a thing or an activity. Like some people will sit there and be like, you know, you get this all the time. You know, I would never play XYZ sport. Oh, you know, why not? Okay, if you played, like, let's say, so I've heard people, like, yeah, football, I've never done. Well, have you ever thrown a football around? You ever done? No. Well, then how do you know that? Again, that's the kind of dumb guy I don't like. Number two, the puts the cart before the horse guy. You get a lot of this in showbiz and also athletics. And what I mean by that is someone who really hasn't put the work in, but then bitches that he's not getting any sort of results.
Mm.
Like I had this when I was a coach, this always would happen. A kid never shows up to lifting. Never shows up, is out of shape, and he's the first kid to bitch, and his parents are the first kids to be, I'll call them kids. His parents are the first kids to bitch that, why isn't my little Johnny playing? Well, you know little Johnny didn't show up. You know little Johnny didn't lift. You know little Johnny's not the best guy we could play. That's what I always love with parents when I'd sit there, and I'm talking to every parent out there. First and foremost, did you stink at sports? Then there's a good chance your kid stinks at sports, okay? Your kid is you, good and bad. So here's the deal. A coach just wants to win. A coach just wants to be successful. No person goes through months and months and years of trying to put together a team and then doesn't play the best guys. If you sit there and you go up to your coach and say, why isn't my son or daughter playing? His honest answer should be he or she is not the best option. But you don't want to hear that. Because you sit there, because you look at it as that's you. And that makes you a dumb guy. So don't be a dumb guy. Your kid's a dumb guy for even complaining. I always had a problem with that. Is some guy, again, some guy who cries in the locker room who never actually went and put any effort into it. But they're sad. Like, how could you be sad? You didn't put anything into this. Again, you're a dumb guy. Now, here are some that didn't make the list before we get to number one.
So they kind of did make the list.
Well, okay, today it's the top seven. We'll go to seven. Okay, this happens in sports a lot. The guy who admits he doesn't know anything about said subject, but then gives you his opinion. That dumb guy. Happens all the time at the bar. Some guy sits there and goes, you know what? I'm going to give him a Yinzer accent because it's like one of the Yinzer things that Yinzers love to do. You know what? I never coach football. I never play football. I really don't know much about the X's and O's of football, but I'll tell you right now, Mike Tomlin can't coach for, you know, and I'm just like, you just admitted you have no knowledge of the sport. You just admitted you have no expertise on the subject, but yet you feel completely free and completely open to give a violent opinion about said subject. This happens all the time. You listen to a bar, you'll at least get one yin. You know what? I know what the statistics say. I know what they're saying on the news. But I'm telling you right now that the crime in this country is out of control. Like, wait a minute. The FBI says crime is at the lowest level in 30 years. I know what they say. I know what everybody's talking about. But I'm telling you this right now. My buddy Chucky just got his lawnmower stolen, and I'm blaming Obama. That's what I'm thinking. And it's none of this stuff used to happen when Reagan was president. Well, weren't you like, you know, 12 years old and didn't own a lawnmower? I remember when I was a kid that every place was better and everything was better. And so I'm blaming it on everybody else. Well, actually, technically, everything is better now. No, everything was better back then. You don't know about that. Again, the quintessential dumb guy at the bar who will just, no matter what subject, no matter what information you give this person, they'll just, I agree. I have never been a woman in my life. I have no vagina. I never had a vagina. I've actually never seen a vagina. But here is my opinion on what is the best feminine hygiene products you can buy. That's essentially what you're saying.
Yes.
So that's like one of my, again, groups of dumb guys. And number one, this is another one. The person who cares deeply about things that don't affect them. Like we talked about before with the mother and daughter that want, the mother and son that want to get together, or a mother and daughter. Who knows? Who cares? It doesn't affect you. And oh, they want to have kids. Great. More ugly kids. Have you seen most kids in the mall? Most of them are ugly. Most kids are ugly because most people are ugly because ugly people get drunk, they get together, they produce ugly offspring. That's how the world works. If everybody was attractive, then there'd be no need for Playboy. There'd be no need for Maxim. If every human being walking down the street was a beautiful model, if everybody down the street was Alex, then there would be no point of that, okay? There'd be no point. There'd be like, oh, why am I looking in this when I can just go to my local 7-Eleven and the person behind the counter is a beautiful person? No, there's a good chance the person behind the counter is a mutant and should never have been born.
Jeez.
And
so
I'm laying down the law. But that's the thing. People who don't care. But then they'll sit there and just, you know, they get all worked up. They say this country's being taken away from us and we got to do something about it. I'm like, does this personally affect you? Absolutely not. It's happening 100 million miles away and it isn't happening. One comic from New York, I remember one time this person came to Pittsburgh. He goes, it's always funny. The people that are most like enraged by terrorism are in places that it'll never happen to. Like, people in New York are just like, no, we don't care if Muslims or, you know, people from other countries, Syrian, whatever, they come to our country, great, fine. It's the person in Johnson City, Tennessee's like, we got a problem with terrorism in this country. And I'm like, nobody is blowing up the Bojangles in Johnson City, Tennessee.
Because that's only thing that's there.
That's the only thing that's there. Now, the number one thing, the number one level of dumb guy that really has made me kind of question the fact that we should have, you know, there's just too many people, is the holy shit, your vote counts the same as mine die. Again, you meet the guy at the bar and he just says something ridiculously stupid and you realize then he sits there and just goes, this is why there's stupid TV shows. Because if I don't watch the TV show, but he does, the TV network goes, oh, someone's watching it. Great. And I sit there and go, wait, his opinion shouldn't count the same as other people, but it does. Everybody gets one vote. Everybody gets one thing. And that just, it blows my mind. Because now I have to get, you know, I have to get on the internet. I have to get on internet radio. I have to make this into a podcast to convince people not to be stupid.
Definitely going to work.
No, it's not. Because there's too many of them. It's just too many of them. To review, this is now getting to the top eight type. This is actually seven. The born on third base dumb guy, the guy who only hangs out with people who agree with him, dumb guy, so he doesn't know other people's opinions, The dumb guy who says something sucks when they've actually never done it or been there. The guy who puts the cart before the horse. The guy who wants the, you know, the guy, you know, the old question is, I want the baby. I don't want the labor pains. Well, then you don't get the baby. Okay. I want the steak, but I don't want to butcher it. Guess what? You'll get no steak if you don't want to butcher it. And other ones, the guy who admits he knows nothing, but gives you his opinion anyway. And again, the guy who cares deeply about things that don't affect him. And the number one guy is the, holy crap, I can't believe this guy has the same pull as me because I'm one person, he's one person. Surrounded by dumb guys. Moving on.
And women. And don't forget them.
Sure. Guys indicates both genders.
Sure.
Yeah. There are dumb women out there. I'm all for, you know, equality. I'm all for it. But I usually run into dumb guys. Women typically have a little bit more of a sense. I'm just being honest.
Okay.
A little bit more sense. Guys, because the thing about it is guys, and I admit this, guys, because their whole lives have been at the top, they feel that their opinion matters even when it means nothing. Whereas women understand that if they say something stupid, people will jump on them and really crash. So they think about it. They'll at least say, okay, I got one chance to make this impression or everyone's going to dismiss me as a moron. Whereas guys, they'll just say, you know what? I'll tell you right now what I think about blah, 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 blah. And no fear, no, absolutely no conscience of the fact that possibly that this guy's sounding like an idiot because he has just that undue confidence.
Case and point.
Case and point, Mr. Michael Sasson.
Yes.
That's what a lot of people are saying. Says, yeah, Mike, it's called looking in a mirror. But we'll end with this. I was listening to a Mark Maron podcast, WTF, because I've been listening to more podcasts. And this was a podcast actually with Patrice O'Neill, the late Patrice O'Neill. And I'm going to play you about the first like minute or two of the podcast because it's the most real statement about what goes into the minds of artists. And then I want to, we'll talk about it a little bit. So
sometimes you get that depressed thing where you go, you know, I wish it was important to more people. You know, I wish I want
self-pity thing. Yeah. Where you like,
I really want more people to, I'd be happier if more people
knew who I was. You get that too?
I just would be happier.
What do you think? Cause I get that all the time too. What do you think it is? What are we not doing right? How come I can't? I've grown to believe that I'm just not for everybody. What the hell am I going to do?
I just had this conversation with Opie, man. And it's like, I'm thinking that if I was a vegetable and I was a Brussels sprout,
yeah,
and I was going, man, I know people love Brussels sprouts.
Yeah, I just have to
get out to the people. But you go, you know what? People might not like Brussels sprouts, man. I so might have what I have. I see the laughter and the reaction from people who love me, and I never want to turn my back on the people who actually enable me to exist.
That's good. You should hold on to that.
Yeah, but I see their reaction. I see the people that I do touch. I touch them on such a real level.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
That I go, there's no way I can be this irrelevant in terms of socially irrelevant, in terms of numbers.
Well, let's.
That is one of the most real like statements in terms of being an entertainer, because you reach a certain level of entertainment and you sit there and someone talks to you and someone comes up to you and goes, hey, Mike, you know, I love that show. I mean, like this past weekend, so many people came up to me and said, hey, Mike, that was great. That was awesome. You know, people saying, you know, I got what you were saying, all of that kind of good stuff. Now, the thing that drives you is you sit there and say, okay, I got to get out to more people. I got to do a podcast. I got to get that's the reason, you know, that, you know, put it bluntly, says I'm not more important to more people. But I just thought it was just the realest kind of like internal monologue Now, these are two comics, so, and that's how I relate to them. It's like the realest comedy thing of just like, you know, but then you go to a point of just like, well, maybe I'm niche. Maybe I'm this. Now, so that's what I thought of when I heard this a couple days ago. But then I kept listening to it and kept reading and listening. And one of the things that got me was I'm like, well, wait a minute. These guys are having these feelings. And these guys have achieved a level of fame that me or anybody else in this city would die for. Yeah, I mean, you know, Patrice O'Neill, before he passed, had, you know, been on television, done Comedy Central specials. It was a national touring guy, one of the most respected comics in the game. Mark Maron had been a national touring guy for 20-something years. Had, you know, been on, you know, done HBO, done Comedy Central, done, and they're talking about it like then. It's like, man, why don't more people know me? And it really gets down to the fact that that no matter where you are, I mean, I bet you even Jerry Seinfeld sits there sometimes and we would sit there and be like, you know, well, you know, what else can I do? Why is it this person? Why my ticket sales? Why did this? And it really does come to the fact that you kind of have to just understand that you just keep moving and you can't think about that. I always talk to other comics and a lot of times when I tell people like give them advice, I'm really kind of giving advice to me as well. Is I sit there and say the only two things you can really affect in your life is your attitude and your effort. Everything else is, you know, how many people listen to this podcast? I can't really control that. All I can do is put it out there as many times. All we can do is we edit it. And that's why I thank Alex, because she does an amazing job, so that people have an opportunity to listen and people have everything like that. And then it just comes down to also just having the proper delivery mechanism. Because I thought about this last night. Like, if it wasn't for chips, would salsa be as popular? No.
Not at all.
Not at all. But that's the key. Salsa found chips. You know? Ketchup found fries. It had to have its proper delivery system. And that's what really every entertainer is trying to find, is the proper delivery system for their brand of comedy or their brand of music or their brand of anything. And that's how you kind of have to focus it. And then I want to leave you with one more. This is like a 2-minute thing. I know we're a little bit over, but this is from Ethan Hawke, and it really talks about the job of an artist. I thought it was really cool.
Without risking looking like an absolute fool, you cannot do anything original, unexpected, anything that comes from your heart. You have to shed the that fear of judgment, and that means you may fall on your ass. And one of the wonderful things is that's our job as members of the artistic community. Your job isn't to succeed. Your job is to be one of many people throwing. You're the wind at the door. You're the wave. One wave is going to crash through, and it may be you or it may be somebody else. But there's a lot of waves that are going to add up to somebody breaking through. I mean, do you think people really look? When Linkletter and I first were going around trying to pitch the idea of Boyhood, I got an idea, right? We're going to make a little short film about a little boy for 12 years. We're going to cut it together. It'll be one movie. It'll be all about childhood. It'll be amazing. So wait, it's coming out in 13 years? And wait, does the little boy sign a contract? You can't sign a contract for more than 7 years. Yeah, but if the boy's having a good time, yeah. So I put my money in now, and if the boy's having a good time, I get it back in 13 years? Yeah, nice. What else do you have? And if you don't try, you don't deserve to be there. I remember one of my, I've said this before somewhere, but like one of my favorite things that Allen Ginsberg ever said was, when he went on the Tonight Show, like as a Hare Krishna and stuff, and somebody said, you know, you're being mocked. And he said, you think I don't know people are making fun of me? That's my job. I'm a poet. And some middle-aged insurance salesman is lying in bed tonight, and he's thinking, what the hell was that guy doing on the Johnny Carson show saying Hare Krishna? And it's breaking the walls of his perception. And that's my job as a poet. My job is not to be liked. I think Allen Ginsberg's highest paying year was $17,000, right? My job is not to make money, you know? I have to, you know, there is some balance at work, you know? I don't want to starve to death. But my job is to be an artist. And to do that, a good artist is ridiculed.
Louis C.K. once said, if you never bomb, it's because you're not pushing the envelope. I don't know. If you have any artistic wants and desires, something to keep in mind. I have those arts, and sometimes I do. Sometimes, you know, you sit there and go, how much do I want to make money? How much do I want to? But sometimes I got to remind myself is that you just kind of have to put yourself out there, find your preferred delivery system, and kind of just go from there. Again, thank you very much to all of you. Again, come up to me, come up to, especially come up to Alex. Because if there's one thing that I love more than anybody, anything else, is Alex getting her due. Because one thing that always gets me is when people just sit there and, you know, because it's the Mike Sasson Show. I want people to know the kind of work that she does. My name is Mike Sasson. I'll see you guys later. Bye. Dun, 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 dun. The music's not working. Dun, 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 dun.